linea su these events, no? These events that are fluctuations that last 1-2 year, okay? Now in 2010 there was a peak of warming due to these fluctuations that last just 2 years. But now that peak is ended. Now the temperature is going down quite fast. So the temperature will still go up and down. Okay, so you may find 1 year, 2 years of warm, but the trend during the last 10 years is almost stable, perhaps a little bit down if we look at the 10-year trend. Very little, but it's there are other problems, because the people who have said that there was that the 2010 was the warmest year of the history, something like that, is the group of the geese of the NASA that are producing data here in America. However, there is the other group in England that produce temperature records that, in my opinion, are maybe better than the one used by NASA for some technical reason. They have more data and so on. There is a little difference between the temperature reconstructed by the NASA group and the temperature reconstructed by this group in England. And according to the data from England, so it is not true that 2010 was the warmest year. So it's relatively lower than what the NASA group say. So there are differences in the data. So not all groups agree with each other. There are slight differences, but the important thing is to look at the trend, not just a peak of warmth. 2010 was at the beginning of 2010 was a peak of warm associated to the El Niño. Now that warming is gone, and the temperature is going down.
Isn't it more scary to have the world get colder because it disrupts the ability for agriculture to happen smoothly?
Yes, I believe so. I believe that the cold, so historically, people have always worried about cold period, not warm period. Historically, that is what happened. So historically, every time that the Earth experienced the cold period, there were problems everywhere. While during warm period, we have the development of the civilization. The reason is that during warm period, there is more rain because there is more evaporation, right? And therefore there is more rain. The agriculture works better because there is also a little bit more sun. So more rain and more sun means more products. Okay, you can produce more food for everybody. And so usually it is better for humanity. I would be more scared about imminent cooling than imminent warming. Because if there is a cooling, there may be people on the earth, in particular the poor countries. So I don't think the United States will suffer much. Okay, so it's not a problem, United States problem. Is a problem for the poor country around the earth. They may have less food, so in Africa, in Asia, and so on. Okay, in Asia, they may have less food. That may create a huge problem because there will be unrest, and so on.
What is a phenomenological model?
I told you, so it's a model that try to understand the cycles, try to model the cycles.
Okay, so that's what it is. That's what it's called.
Study the phenomenon as it appears. So the phenomenon presents cycles. So there are these secular cycles, 1,000-year cycle. There is some 100-200-year cycle. There is also a 60-year cycle in the temperature that appears to be quite evident. So, for example, the warming that has been observed from the 70s to 2000 is very likely, grand part of it is part of a 60-year cycle. So what we observe is, if you look at my picture, so what is observed from the data is that there was a warming between 1850 and 1880, then there was a cooling between 1880 and 1910, then there was a warming between 1910 and 1940, a cooling between 1940 and 1970, a warming between 1970 and 2000, and now there is a new cooling. So this is a 60-year cycle. 60-year cycle is found in many data, and is found in astronomical data. It's found in the solar activity. It's found in the oscillations of the solar system, and so it's found in many places, including calendars. Ancient calendars from Chinese are organized in 60-year cycle. So it's found more or less everywhere. And this is one of the big cycles that quantum models, for example, do not reproduce. And because they are missing this cycle, they interpret the warming between 70 and 2000 as due to CO2. However, if there is a natural cycle of 60-year natural cycle, grand part of that warming is due to this natural cycle and not to CO2.
Do you think that the sea is rising?
Mm-hmm. See, okay, the sea is rising, but that is a process that lasts since 50,000 years. So it's rising since the end of the glaciation, Great Glaciation. Now, the ocean is actually decelerating now. It's rising a little bit, but the acceleration is slightly negative. So practically, the rate is decreasing a little bit right now. So what is observed from the data is that there is a big acceleration of the ocean since the 17th century. The 17th century was a period of it was the center of the Little Ice Age. So the things were quite frozen. Then when the Little Ice Age ended, the glaciers started to melt, of course the ocean rise a little bit. And so we observe a strong acceleration of these things. But since probably 1920, 1930 and so on, the acceleration became negative. So practically it is slowing down. It is not going up. No, the acceleration is not positive. It's not pointing up. It is pointing a little bit down. So this is also this is a contradiction between the data and what the models say. The models are talking about this positive acceleration in the level of the oceans that would be very problematic for the cost and so on. However, the data show a negative acceleration that started at least 80 years ago, and I believe that the ocean will still continue to rise, but not too much. Okay, so I calculated here in North Carolina from the data that we have in Wilmington. I calculated that for 2100, so at the end, so by 2100, the ocean may rise by 10-20 centimeters, while the programs, the computer models, have predicted 1 meter. Okay, so we are talking about ten times less than what forecasted.
That's pretty profound.
So that is a problem. So it's evident that if the climate models cannot be trusted,